Well, it's really great to see most of you somehow. And I'm just going to share with you my reopening experience I have. And I'm not saying it's correct. I'm just saying it's what I've done. I even have a legal disclaimer at the end. And everyone here knows who I am. I don't have to go into the next slide, but I've given this lecture before. So there's people who don't know me and don't know about my kids and my grandkids. And I got three wonderful grandchildren, which I'm very, very happy with, and the lovely kids. But the most important thing, and we all know this, has been patient communication. Today, we had numerous phone calls at the office. Patients asking if they can get in today because they heard on the news that the governor has opened up dental offices. And we're explaining to everyone we're still in the training mode. We've done a lot of communication with our mass communication program, which is Next Health. We use that because it does integrate with our Dentrix Ascend program. We've been sending them out newsletters and updating everything on social media as you're supposed to. But as all of you know about the newsletters and text messages, many of your patients opt out. So they don't get these messages when you tell them everything. One cool thing is we have been doing telemedicine because we got a free trial of Confrere with Next Health. So we've been doing telemedicine, which is really cool. I don't know what program you guys have been using, but you can actually have patients schedule time to have a telemedicine conference with you. Then you send them a secure link by text or email. And then they can reply back to you and you can talk to them. They can send you pictures and it's all very secure and HIPAA compliant. So if you guys have been doing that, that's wonderful. I've been seeing some really weird things and I don't like them making their appointments to do it because I like to do it when I'm available. So I like to send them a time saying this is a time that we can teleconference. So again, that's just with Confrere that we've been using. Our first newsletter that went out was very direct and to the point, telling them all that their appointments had been canceled up until May 4th and explaining that it was not that we had decided to do it. It was because it was what was decided for us by all the entities, you know, what the American Dental Association felt, the state government felt, the Illinois Department of Public Health, and that we would only be doing emergent care and we would see patients and we just would stabilize them. And so we didn't want them showing up at the emergency room. And I have been actually quite busy with a number of kids with abscess teeth. And it's just been skyrocketing very, very quickly. Orthodontically, Mike Durbin, he was very upfront, just sending him notices saying, hey, we're not going to do anything. We just don't want to have any overcorrection. So, you know, be careful with your aligners and your retainers. And he put out his own personal cell number to all the patients and say, if you have any questions, call me anytime. And he's been really great at calling and talking to the patients and just say, hey, don't worry about it, you're fine. We'll get you done when we can. And we told him right away about the reopening. And for our reopening, which we haven't done yet, but this is how we've been doing the emergencies, is they check in by phone when they park their car. They can only come up to our office when they wear masks. They are only the patient and one accompanying adult, and I had an emergency this afternoon. Both parents came, which is very frustrating, and we don't want to have both parents just showing up, but both parents showed up. They have to complete health histories, anyone who shows up, and their exposure questionnaire. I'm sure you've all seen that, and we have warned people in advance that we will take everyone's temperature, just like we do our employees, and that we warn them in advance that testing may be required of them. I'll show you pictures of everything, but we completely redid our reception area to have assigned seating areas. And with the assigned seating areas, they can maintain their social distancing. And only patients are allowed in treatment areas. And this is because, you know, it's a pediatric orthodontic office, and we had people come in with cousins, nephews. Kids would come in to play with all the iPads and to get toothbrushes and get toys and all this. So we had to make sure that everyone knows that is no longer the norm. You can't just show up with everybody. The whole family would show up. One kid would have an appointment and be grandma, grandpa, uncle, aunt, parents. And that all aerosol-producing procedures are in closed operatories. And when we told them that hygiene would only happen after we were allowed to do it. Meanwhile, I was really big on making sure that if they were using preventative products, that they continued to do so. I think this is so important because, you know, this was an opportunity for us to shine when it comes to prevention, is, you know, really push. And I did the probiotics, the MIPase, xylitol mouth rinses, and so on, and told them to call us if they had any questions. And I put my email out for everyone and teleconferencing to say, hey, you know, avoid the carbs and all the issues associated with it, and you know, practice all the stuff we told you guys to do. And we warned them that they're coming back to a new situation. And I really feel that our patients expect that they expect the office to look different. They expect the protocols to be different because everyone's been through a pandemic. And they go to Home Depot and they see plexiglass everywhere by the cashiers. So my feelings are they expect to see our offices different too. I would. So this is what I've been doing the last few weeks. I have been so busy with getting the walls done, doing the ceiling, cleaning out all the vents. I repainted the ceiling. I've had walls redone, touched up. I built protective shields for the front desk, plexiglass shields. The carpet was just shampooed Sundays. The floors are being waxed tomorrow night. We went through everything. We got the hypochlorous acid generators, so we have additional disinfection for fogging. We got HEPA UVC air cleaning units in all the operatories. We worked to get it so we can get some negative pressure where we do our main operatory and aerosol producing procedures. I've been working with ADP payroll to have a questionnaire, a punch list for our employees. When the team members come in to work, when they try to punch in on their phones, the first thing that comes up is a questionnaire asking them, how do they feel? Have they been sick? Have they been traveling? And so here, if you can see it, is if you look real careful, you can see that's a plexiglass shield. I custom made those and stained the wood so it would match the top of the desks. And there I am behind with the stuff that we have for our PPE. At first, all I could get were peach scrub caps. So we had all peach. Now we have the black ones and all the other colors. But we would go ahead and, of course, do the temps on the employees and everyone. And what we've been trying to do, I had on order from Benco, and we were supposed to get the BioSys for antibody testing for the team members. That got held up. But we did get in our isolation gowns, our N95s, masks, our face shields are all in. We have our CPAP cleaning units for the nitrous units. And we're doing training, and this is what we're doing this week. We've been reassigning duties, those employees over the age of 65, and I've had a number of people who've been with me for 30 years. It's kind of surprising when I think about how many people have been with me for a long time. I had to order a bunch of new scrubs for the doctors and teams. This is the BioSys Plus antibody test. This is something I really want to do. I really want to do it for the employees who are supposed to have it, but I have pre-ordered the Clarifies, and I've been approved to get the Clarify system for Medline so we can test for IgM and IgG. I think the Clarify actually does IgA also. And that is depending on state law, but antibody testing, the original ones had a lot of problems, as you know, and as of April 22nd, there were 29 commercial assays available for sale in the United States. Only three have been granted FDA's backing for emergency use. A good friend of mine who's a very well-known researcher, he has a POC unit coming out, a point of contact unit, where he can run three tests at one time in the unit. And not only can you do your antibody testing, but they also are capable of actually doing molecular testing for three different microbes in the same unit. And he will be selling it to dental offices in August. So you'll be able to actually test for not just coronavirus, but you'll be able to test for H1N1 and even possibly hepatitis C and many other pathogens. He's a very strong believer that dentists should be protecting themselves. He's a very well-known physician researcher. And so I'm pretty excited about that. He also has the mitochondrial test that he can run too off the same unit. I made an arrangement with two internal medicine guys in my building. So they were co-signing the test. So there's no question of legality on it. These are finger stick tests, the Clarify test and the BioCyst test. If you can see the chart to your right, the accuracy figures for selected COVID-19 antibody tests, some of them like the Abbott Labs one, that's the ID Now test that was a layer and got bought by Abbott. Now Thermo Fisher Scientific has it. And it's really very high. I hope it's not blocked from the gallery. But if you look at the epitope diagnostics, it's only about 45% sensitive. So you're going to miss out on a lot. The Chinese test systems that were coming out had a 40 to 50% false negative. So that's why so many people could be tested and show up perfectly fine and then get tested again for their molecular tests and show that they have it and could spread it. And so many of those were really bad, and they're actually available in the United States. And my buddy who is with MitoSwab said that a local garage owner has thousands of test kits he got from China, but they probably average only 40 to 50% accurate, just like what the CDC was turning out. Now, what we've been doing for general anesthesia preparation is we have the Lurie Children's in Northbrook drive-through, so our patients drive-through for a nasal pharyngeal. But we stopped using that because we went to the oral DNA, oral risk COVID-19, I'll show you, which is actually not a nasal pharyngeal. I need to change that. It's just a nasal swab and saliva collection. And that still needs about 72 hours, but the patients come in. And then you get this report, like you see, this Jane Doe report on your right. And this test is called the oral risk COVID-19. Now, a lot of you probably remember oral DNA because they've been around for a long time. But MicroGen Dex also has one. They get theirs done in 48 hours. It's highly accurate also, and it's $99. Viome has a fecal one that the patients can do at home and ship in. It shows that the viral titer, you can clear that for up to 2 weeks after you have no more virus showing nasally. So it's really very, very accurate. And then Viome also has an oral one, but they also have that new oral cancer test. Viome has an oral cancer test they're coming out with that can detect oral cancer with an accuracy of 91.9%. prior to clinical signs. And this, I think, is extremely awesome. And I think that this should be a standard of care for us in the future. And I'm part of their trial on that. So I'm really excited to see that going. And this, again, this isn't new stuff. I've been doing caries risk tests in the mid-1990s. So oral testing has been around. Like oral DNA has been around since 2008. MicroGen Dex also came out in 2008. And I actually visited oral DNA back when they came out in Brentwood, Tennessee. And I was up there 2 weeks ago at Eden Prairie in Minnesota when they had their inaugural run of their system for testing. And again, Oral DNA Labs has a bunch of testing. You know, you can do your myperiopath. You can do the genetic DNA showing who is actually at risk for inflammation to perio and also any inflammation in general. But they've had around for a long time their oral risk HPV and their oral risk HSV. And of course, their Candida oral risk test too. So they can actually pick up a number of the HPVs with their testing. Their OurRisk COVID-19 test is a very diagnostic one. You do a nasal swab and you do a spit, and I'll show that to you. And it does not falsely detect any other virus like SARS virus. It's extremely accurate, 99.99% accurate. And you see that virus coming out nasally often within just 2 or 3 days after the patient is positive for it, when they actually, after they've contacted their source of contamination. And then you continue to shed it. And like I said, you can shed it fecally for up to 2 weeks after you actually have had symptoms. This is how they say that we can get back to work a lot safer, because if you have a patient who needs an extensive amount of procedures done, like an all-on-4 case, or someone who needs an extensive amount of visits, like might be coming in to see you, Mark Landau, 4 or 5 times, and you got a treatment plan that's a $3,000 or $4,000 treatment plan, it might make a lot of sense to test this patient first. And all they have to do is come to your office and spit, and then in 72 hours, you know if they've had the exposure. This is actually the setup I use for my employees coming back. Many of them were concerned about, you know, someone's going to come in that has coronavirus, they're going to infect the entire team, all my employees are going to be sick. So here I have a stack of the OurRisk COVID-19 tests, where all I have them do is, you know, I swab the nose and I have them spit into the tube. And you have these packs to keep it cold, they send it off as soon as possible. And one other thing, I just kind of left it there for fun. In all the bathrooms, we have the signs up saying, close toilet lid before flushing, then wash hands, and then spray the disinfectant. Because as all of you guys know, a lot of it has been spreading through plumes from toilets, just like the original SARS. So Microgendex is another company I've been involved with for quite some time, and they actually sent me a couple emails saying, hey, we're ready, we got our saliva check. It's 99.99% accurate. And so again, they send you either a vial or a cup to spit in. You can have patients do this or your employees. But if you have a lot of visits, like some of the emergencies I've seen, they're gonna be coming back for 4 or 5 visits. I like to make sure that they're clear before they come into the office. So you gotta cough up some, and you can't cough up some phlegm, and then you spit into the tube, into this case a cup, as they're showing, and they show you the amount you need to have, where the blue is. And you have to be careful packing it up, and they keep telling people it can't spill, you got to keep it clean. I wash my hands, I put gloves on, I put a mask on because I don't want to contaminate it. Then you have to drop it off in a FedEx box. So that's why I know there's a FedEx box not far from me on the way home. I drop off the container in a FedEx box. So this is actually what mine looked like. You can see mine right there. And I wanted to make sure I got that done before we started back with patients. And here's actually my test results here. This is from April 30th right there. And this is when they completed it on May 1st. So I knew I was clear at that time from any SARS-CoV-2 virus. So I just think it's a good idea, because you can tell your team members, you can tell your patients, if they balk about being tested, that, hey, I've done it myself. It's not such a big deal. So ideally then, again, if it's any big procedure, you want to make sure that you get that done, the salivary testing done. Like I said, if you're doing a $2,000 or $3,000 or $4,000 case, who cares about $99? They have to bring their own masks. I know a lot of people are offering to give masks to patients coming in, but you know, I think that's such a waste. They had to wear a mask to get to your office. They should be wearing the mask. Having the hydrogen peroxide rinse, we have the Colgate's peroxide, and we also have prevention for kids, which is a hydrogen peroxide one. And we've been doing lots of temporization and silver diamine fluoride, and then trying to get the patients to take responsibility for their own preventive care. Testing for the perio pathogens, and you might as well. I mean, if you guys are doing a lot, I just think it's a good idea while you're doing the testing, might as well test for the perio pathogens anyway. And for now, we're only seeing patients who are healthy ASA1. I don't feel like I should be bringing in all my disabled patients and special needs patients right now. And quite frankly, every office I know who's been open on Saturdays is thinking about closing down Saturdays because of all the extensive maintenance going on. And quite frankly, I'm worn out just from all the stuff that we had to do. And we're planning, when we bring back hygiene, on using the Butler proficiency cups because they're paceless. And that's what I normally use for disabled patients anyway. And then just making sure you have a really good vacuum system, because it's interesting when I might visit a friend and he's finishing a procedure. I hear his vacuum is so wimpy. And go like, holy cow, how can you run a high volume evacuation at such a low amount? And ours usually runs between 25 and 28 millimeters mercury pole. It's a good Siemens unit. And so venting the outside and having the ozone generators are special use, and I'll show that for you. And fluoride varnish for the older patients, APF foam for the younger patients. And the reason we're on the younger patients, and we haven't really talked about prevention on this, but you hear people say, oh, use fluoride varnish on little kids. You guys know it doesn't work, right? I mean, here's a great review by Jeremy Horst. Everyone knows Jeremy Horst, published about 2 years ago. 5 out of 6 studies employing fluoride varnish showed no prevention of new lesions on little kids. That's why we went back to using APF foam on little kids, is because all the studies are really disappointing. And if you don't believe me, on the right, you see all the studies and the results. Hopefully the gallery isn't blocking them, but like no effect. And so I really feel that, you know, these kids need to kind of come in and be seen and have radiographs taken and the silver diamine fluoride done or temporization done, so they don't go around like all the emergencies I've seen. Like I get these phone calls. Our daughter hasn't slept for 3 days. You know, that's a lot to ask from a 4-year-old or a 5-year-old. I mean, it's not like you can give them good pain meds, you know, like the parents would be getting some really good pain meds, but the poor kids are just suffering and all that. And even with the silver diamine fluoride, you got to have radiographs. This was done by a pediatrician. Pediatrician treated that lower first primary molar, and 3 days later, the child's in my office with severe pain. I mean, the silver diamine fluoride didn't do that, but pediatricians, they can't take radiographs. If you can't get a radiograph, I mean, obviously that tooth needs a pulp. It needed a pulp when the SDF was done. So the pediatrician did the SDF and said, you're fine now. You don't need to see a dentist, because I treated it. I took care of it. And the other thing on that is, don't do a fluoride varnish and an SDF at the same time. And this is for my friends up in Minneapolis. That's a lot of fluoride for a little kid. And we hear about people doing that all the time. I SDF, then I did a fluoride varnish. That's never been studied. And it's the dose would be additive, and the safety profile is not known. It's never been studied. So how do we change around the office? Let's show some pictures here. We have a check-in station outside, and there's all my leftover chairs because I have no more room for them in the reception area. And even in the hallway, like I said, we had the whole office building was done, shampooed really well. I went and disinfected all the chairs and removed everything, even in the hallway, for all the other offices. Patients only come up when they're texted, and then they're told to come in. They're examined first, temperature taken, make sure we have on their phones that they filled out the questionnaire, that they have no symptoms. Then they stop at station A there, and they use hand sanitizer and make sure their masks are on. They are assigned areas. If you look real carefully, you'll see all the letters on the walls. And we have HEPA air filters there just to make sure everyone in the reception room feels fine, but everything is spaced. At first, I bought seat covers, which we could put on and off the chairs, but then I just took all the chairs and had them all recovered with a Naga hide. Office disinfection. You heard Dr. Benkover was talking about fogging with hypochlorous acid. We're getting the disinfectant shield, which is FDA registered, EPA approved disinfectant. It does kill coronavirus on contact, and it disinfects for up to 30 days. So you spray it and you're good for up to 30 days. Interesting technology on it because it uses these like 4 nanometer crystals that are composed of silica dioxide. They're in a suspension and it kills and keeps the all microbial life, all viruses, everything, bacteria, flu virus, everything. It's been well tested and it is extremely expensive. But you spray it once, and I know that a lot of people are spraying the filters on their HEPA filters with this because anything that hits this is killed. But it's funny because it has absolutely no toxic effect to humans whatsoever because it's all structural. Remember sharklet tautology where you could buy sheets of sharklet and bacteria couldn't grow on it? And we even did a study on that. It's really amazing stuff. It can't form colonies on it and it dies because it cannot colonize and replicate. So it simply dies. CDC posters are required to be posted throughout the office. So I just went and printed up a bunch of them from the CDC and laminated them. And, you know, we have the different peroxide mouth rinses. We have the Perio one too. That's the 3% also, but that's too strong for kids. You know, I think this is really interesting things because, you know, there's just 5 or 10% a xylitol nasal spray, and they've known this forever, really takes care of chronic rhinosinusitis biofilms and has been shown to really cut back on staph epidermidis, staph aureus, and Pseudomonas aeruginosa. And this has been well studied and published in all the medical literature. So, you know, to me, it would make sense, really, if you worry about transmission, is to spray the nose some. And these are all over-the-counter sprays. I know a lot of people, before they use their CPAP, will spray with clear nasal spray. And like I said, a lot of this research goes way, way back, like 1995, because, you know, it actually inhibits the strep pneumonia and Haemophilus influenza just at 1 to 5%. So it doesn't take very much. And most of these nasal sprays are about 10% xylitol. But what's really is interesting about this is that if you do xylitol supplemental nutrition, it heavily prolongs the survival of rats when they give them pneumococcal sepsis. And this stuff has been published a lot. I mean, this has been studied, like this came out of Finland, but you know, they added, quote, nutritional xylitol, and it greatly increased the survival rats when they gave them a pneumococcal sepsis. I mean, it's really fascinating. And that's just like what we use to prevent caries, right? And for treatment of prevention of caries and perio, it's just your good old, you know, spry gem mints and stuff like that we've been doing all the time. But what you may not realize is that if you look at the publications, this is from 4 years ago, with certain viruses like human respiratory syncytial virus, the same thing is greatly ameliorated and greatly reduces the inflammation because xylitol is strongly anti-inflammatory. If you look in the perio literature, you see that. So, and this is again in rodent model because obviously you can't do this in humans, but they give dietary xylitol and it also helps against influenza infection. And this is again when they give a massive viral load, a lethal load of influenza, and it greatly reduces the immune effect, the inflammatory storm that happens, the cytokine storm. So this is one of the things they were doing in South Korea. And that's why I was talking to several people like University of Minnesota Medical Center and people at Northwestern and all that. But, hey, why don't you add a little xylitol to your nebulizers and to your respirators? Because add 5 or 10% knocks out a lot of bacteria and knocks out a lot of viruses. And they kept saying, well, there's no benefit for them financially because you can't patent it. And everyone was doing clinical studies. Everyone said, well, we got clinical study. We're getting a lot of money to study this stuff. Well, Cleveland Clinics actually has been doing a study using xylitol with chlorpheniramine. And chlorpheniramine in xylitol in a nasal spray really knocks out SARS-CoV-2. So I got some of the stuff on order. And I'm pretty excited because I really think that, you know, the nose is another potential avenue. We have rinse with the hydrogen peroxide mouth rinse. Maybe they should squirt some of this up their nose too and kill the virus in their nose before we do any treatment with them, right? So just something. So the HEPA filters I have the UVC unit in them. There's because we have small operatories they're in, there's 12 of them in the office, and we set them up so they, you know, blow the clean air on us and then blow away from us. And of course, I've always used rubber dam in a high volume evacuator that's set really, really high. Or if you simply go and spend a lot of money, you can buy the world's best indoor air purifier, the Jade system, which I have a lot of friends who are doing this. They're buying Jades. And I keep asking them, how do you know it's the world's best indoor air purifier? And well, it's because they say it is. You know, and advertisers never lie, right? Ralph says, they never lie to us. But I know a couple oral surgeons who've bought Jade units and so on. Everyone else, you know, as long as you get a medical grade one, I mean, here's one for $160 on sale. It does 500 square feet, and none of our operatories are 500 square feet. I mean, it's just at least, to me, even if it doesn't do a whole lot, at least it's making your team members feel better, make your patients feel better, and it should help. It's a medical grade, at least they claim it is. The IQ Air has been selling like crazy. It is Swiss made. It's about $900 a unit. But see, again, that does, look at how powerful it goes up to 1,125 square feet. Man, that's a lot. I mean, because all of our operatories are you know, singular rooms, that'd be overkill for me, for sure. But UV disinfection, as they said in the Illinois recommendations, has been shown to be effective at eliminating coronavirus. And there's been articles on it. So I'm going like, well, as long as I have a HEPA filter with UVC, I feel a little bit better that at least I'm trying everything. And thank God we have windows, because I did buy window fans and we're on the third floor, so I don't have to worry about the exhaust. I can turn on the fan and blow air outside. And since we have at least 2 to 3 weeks of good weather every year in Chicago, that's good 2 or 3 weeks a year I can use that. Just a little joke there. Ralph, you're supposed to laugh. Mark, you're not laughing at all. Oh, thank you. Ralph did. So the other issue is I used to have a lot of things sitting out. And you can't have anything out, you know, you can have it out if it's in a box, but then you have to unbox it to give it to the patient, or you have to get it in sealed containers. So I went crazy putting everything away in cabinets and putting things in sealed containers, you know, apothecary jars, and buying anything I could. You know, like just look at the laser glasses. I have to put those in containers. So I went and bought all the sealed containers I could for things I couldn't fit into drawers, just to make sure there's absolutely nothing out that could be, you know, exposed. And then I'm putting like the kids' safety glasses places with the, you know, our employees have colored them up and make them look nice, and then go like, holy cow, how about my paper towels and how about my mask and everything else that I have on, you know, sitting there. So I thought, well, shoot, I have all these bouffant hair things. I can cover up my mask with that. You know, I can wash my hands, reach up, pull out gloves, pull it back down so the plume won't get to it. I won't have an aerosol get to it. And I thought, you know, that may not actually protect it well enough. And I hope you guys don't really laugh at me. But shower caps. I bought a bunch of shower caps. And I've just been covering everything with shower caps. If you look at the left side, shower caps, you can buy 100 like for $6, $7, and they're impervious. So anything like, you know, we keep everything in cabinets as much as possible, but then again, you're degloving to open the cabinet door, but you can't do that, but you're not supposed to stick your hand with a glove inside a cabinet. So I'm trying to figure out everything. And the shower cap seems to be the most reasonable thing for us, is having a shower cap. And like I said, I got covers for the chairs. I didn't like the covers, so I ended up getting everything reupholstered with, as you can see, with the U.S. Naugahyde Millennium Spirit, because that's the disinfection resistant materials. And I can spray that whole area down with hypochlorous and I'll be fine. Or I can use the disinfectant shield. And again, where the disinfectant shield is undisturbed for 30 days after you fog, it's antimicrobial. So, but it's really expensive. Bathrooms. Just reading up on what they're doing in many states besides Illinois. Illinois did not address it, which is really surprising, because many people who've gotten COVID-19, they feel it's been happening in the bathrooms. That's what happened with SARS and the Hong Kong flu. It was bathroom. And one of the things they've shown is there's a big plume every time the toilet is flushed. And that is kind of unsettling, because, you know, and that's why it'd be great to have separate bathrooms, that patients should not be using the same bathroom as your team members. And fortunately, we have hallway bathrooms for our patients, and we have bathrooms within the office for our team members. And so that is very fortunate, because that's also their changing area. But if you look at the studies of the contamination after the toilet is flushed, it's just unbelievable what happens. That's why it's so important to close the darn lid. And you saw the sign already I put everywhere, you know, close the lid, then flush, then wash your hands, then disinfect the area. So it's really important. I put in personal bags too. All these personal bags are initialed, because what do you do if you have to take a break and take a phone call? You don't want to ruin your N95 mask. I mean, because I've been seeing emergencies, and then someone says, you got to take this phone call. And I go like, oh my God, once you touch an N95, it's no good. Yeah, I don't want to ruin this N95, because I've been covering it the whole day with a face shield and a level 3. So I got these bags, and I have an ozone generator, which is to your right there. And I fill the bag with ozone and seal it. And during lunch and coffee, if someone takes a break, they can do that. And so during that time, that N95 mask is being sterilized. I did buy a UVC sterilizer for it, which hasn't come yet. So I don't even know if that really works, which we'll talk about a little bit. And I also have the ability to microwave it with the hydrogen peroxide. So you add a little hydrogen peroxide in there and throw it in the microwave and do it for 3 minutes. You get a really good steam. And of course, the microwave itself has been shown to kill the coronavirus, but really great with the vaporous hydrogen peroxide. And I can do that while I'm making the phone call, and I can put on a clean mask. So now I'll probably get criticized. Someone will probably say, well, you shouldn't do that. But the state of Illinois is offering to do hydrogen peroxide vapors for us for free. So they must feel that it is important. I have no idea how well these UVC wands work. I did order one, and supposedly it's FDA cleared, and it hasn't shown up yet. One thing for my nitrous units, I've got CPAP units to clean them. And this, I think, is so cool, because the CPAP adapters fit right on the nitrous unit, and you plug it in, and you see your bag fill. And it's actually ozonating out the whole system. It goes all the way back to that one-way valve. Remember, there's a one-way valve inside your unit, so the patient can't push air into the unit. So it goes back, and it disinfects the whole thing for 30 minutes, and let it sit. You flush it, then let it sit. So that means the nitrous unit has to sit for at least an hour. But the whole thing is completely, totally clean. And the scavenger tubing, which is scavenging it the whole time, I put that in bleach. The pulse ox, we picked up some extra little tiny pulse ox just to double check everything. And we have our good, big, expensive ones. But just as a screening thing, some people have asked, you know, if we could do pulse ox to make sure, because supposedly some people can drop down way to like 50s and 60s and not know it. I find that really hard to believe, but there's been physicians, and I took that one webinar, so you can get those. And here's the scavenging tube. Now remember, that's going, because we're using the portal silhouette, that whole portion of the nasal hood going back is disposable. But where it gets to the scavenging, that's going straight into the vacuum, which is vented outside. So you have a closed circuit. So I have this four-year-old in the chair with a rubber dam on, and I'm doing their operative, and they're getting in the air from the oxygen and the nitrous tank through the nitrous unit, which is clean, non-contaminated air. They breathe it out, and it goes right into the scavenger, right, and gets scavenged and ejected to the outside. So that's what, you know, I think is a pretty fair way of keeping it clean. And I've always used bleach tablets too, and bought bleach tablets. Each one of those containers is like 20 gallons. So that works really good. And so there's the Porter Silhouette low profile nasal mask. And again, you know, cleaning the whole system out. For the nitrous oxide analgesia, the only thing is still the MTHFR mutation contraindication, but we always do our pre-ops with the vitamin B12, NAC, and methylfolinic acid anyway. You know, and rather than going to the operating room, I think this is a lot safer, and I think it reduces aerosol risk, to be honest with you. And that brings up environmental testing, because one of the things I've always done is, you know, every year or so, I check the level of nitrous oxide we have leaking in the office, and you're supposed to be at below 25 parts per million. So I've been buying monitors to do it. And so I talked to Oral DNA, and we have two monitor systems now for coronavirus. And we have a swab set of four that you can swab your reception desk, your operatory, another operatory, and reception area, and send it in, and they'll tell you what type of aerosol generation you have going on in your office, and hopefully you have none, and then you can tell patients that you've been tested. We also have the canister that you twist open, kind of like an air wick one, and then you let it sit for 8 hours, and you close it, and that'll give you a time-weighted average of what your aerosol is like. Now, you're going to say, why is that important? I can tell you right now that there's a major airline that is also talking to Oral DNA about making their environmental testers. I know that some chains are going to be doing it, where they're going to do environmental testing, because they're going to make sure everything's clean. They're going to do their disinfectant shield, and they're going to test, and then they're going to be able to say, hey, we have actually tested. We are not contaminating anything. And I think that's wonderful for dentistry. I think that we're going to be able to actually test and pass, all of us, that we're doing the right thing. And that's going to really alleviate your fears of your patients and the fears of your team members. Have you guys been talking to your team members coming back? I tell you that mine are like really worried about it. And look, we have the good old days there, no masks, no glasses, and unwashed beard was perfectly fine. And but now, you know, it's going to be surface testing, and I'm pretty excited to be piloting some of this stuff, and I'm seeing if we can make it so we can keep the offices really clean. And hopefully in a couple of weeks I'll have some results to be sharing with you guys. Why doesn't the APA talk about using all this stuff for COVID-19? Well, if you actually go to the EPA sites, you'll see what it says. It says right there, list N only includes disinfectants registered by EPA and does not include devices, because that's not their job. The EPA does not evaluate devices for how well they disinfect. So it's just not my job, Mon. That's why you don't see these evaluations. Now, I think the safest population for me to start with is children, and we've really got to do everything we can to protect the elderly and postpone care in the high-risk population. And that's what I've been telling the parents of a lot of my kids. If they're stable and they have a lot of medical issues, I have a lot of cerebral palsy kids, I don't want them coming in. They already get pneumonia 3 times a year. So I think that'd be, until this pandemic has calmed down, I'm telling them just do all they can prevention-wise. And hopefully we'll have antibody testing really quickly. I was told I actually have my antibody test kit for the office and within the next 2 weeks. And then, you know, if the hygienist can work with hand scaling and use the Butler proficiency cups, they're not going to get much of a aerosol at all. I understand that in the state of Washington, which has opened up, that the hygiene association has demanded that every hygienist has an assistant who sits there and uses a high volume evacuation while they're doing their cleaning, and to cut back on the aerosol. So you may be hearing that from your assistants and from your hygienists. I like to use the electric ones. We use the cordless hand pieces for a lot of little kids because to them it's less threatening anyway, and there's no air being generated. So that's what we like to use. Washable gowns are allowed for non-aerosol procedures, and for the orthodontist, you know, they can use washable gowns for anything that's non-aerosol producing. And MedClean is a company we signed up with for our washable gowns, and they drop off washable gowns and they pick them up. So, you know, especially with the orthodontics and retainer checks and all that, you don't have to ruin your good PPE. You can use a washable gown. Patient checkout is all done remote. There's no direct contact. With this, they are sent a request for payment, as you can see right here. We just send it by text to their cell phone. See, I sent a text to Joe Got Cash for services on April 28th for an emergency. The reason was I need to pay my bills. And I only asked for a mere $10 million, or I guess that's only $1 million. Darn, I should ask for more. But again, that way there's no direct contact and the receptionist can stay behind the protective shields, which helps a whole lot. I actually thought this wouldn't happen because the curve started to flatten the number of deaths back on April 7th, which is a while ago. But it seemed like there was, you would never have gathered that from the news reports. And this is actually taken from the state of Illinois' actual figures, and has continued to go down. With young people, COVID toes. I'm sure you guys have been hearing about that and the Kawasaki disease, like 100 cases in the United States, they think. COVID toes is really interesting. They get these swollen areas. It's an autoimmune reaction. There's so much we don't know about this virus. Isn't it really crazy? Because we haven't seen this before. This COVID toe right there had got worse, so it had a punch biopsy done, and it was originally diagnosed as chilblains. And one of the things I was seeing in kids, and this is by telemedicine, was, I hope you guys can see it, the gallery isn't blocking it on you like it is me. I'll minimize the gallery. There we go. But the around some erupting teeth, we've been seeing the same type of lesions just developing. This is sent to me by a parent saying, what is this? And I said, well, it could just, you got a fragment of a baby tooth there too. But I've had a lot more of these ever since the pandemic. So I'm wondering if we're looking at COVID gums. And I talked to a very well-known pediatric dermatologist, Dr. Amy Powler, about it. She says, you know, you never know. A little chronic inflammation around a nail, then you got, because it's COVID toes, you get a little chronic inflammation around an erupting tooth or a loose primary tooth, and may have COVID gums. But, you know, I'm not going to biopsy it just to find out. And what's kind of ironic about all this is that, you know, we're looking at zoonotic disease again. And zoonotic diseases happen when humans and animals intersect. And these are some slides from a lecture I gave 6 years ago. And I gave a big lecture 6 years ago on this, about talking about, this is exactly what this, I took this slide and just put it in this format about the 1918 flu pandemic, the Spanish flu, and the 50 to 100 million dead and how it affected everything, and how the CDC was predicting it would come back a similar type of pandemic. So we have to expect more. I mean, not just the SARS one that we had that got started, or the MERS had started and petered away, but now SARS-CoV-2 and COVID-19. And, you know, if you start stacking animals or people on top of each other, you're bound to have more and more of these diseases and things that, you know, like, you know, we know of the swine flu and the bird flu and the equine flu and all these flus. And again, you know, zoonotic diseases are diseases that start from animals and go to humans. We have so many examples like anthrax and dengue and Ebola and Lyme disease, malaria, plague, and all these things. And in fact, you know, 75% of all the recently emerging infectious disease are of animal origin. 60% of all of our pathogens are zoonotic. They actually came from other animals before. So we shouldn't be surprised about all this at all. And they've been major killers of humanity throughout all of our recent history. And this is a colorized picture that was taken in the 1890s, but it's been since colorized, showing the crowding that we have and how diseases like tuberculosis was such a huge killer in the 1880s and 1890s and all that. And, you know, we have all these diseases that go through because we have dense populations. And we didn't have these dense populations before as hunter-gatherers. But if you look, a lot of them, like measles, tuberculosis, and smallpox, and it came from cattle, and the flu from pigs and ducks, and, you know, and birds, and pertussis from dogs and pigs, and so forth. Now, what about legal concerns? Well, I was talking to an attorney up in Minneapolis who specializes in this. And the big discussion with this guy, actually specializes in testing for diseases and so on. He said, you know, there's two major concerns about dental offices. One is the concern for the patients, and the other concern is for your dental team. And that's why one of the big bills that's sitting in Congress is, you know, liability protection for offices that open. Can you imagine opening, one of your employees comes in and they're sick and they get everyone else sick? And there's really nothing new with this, except for the fact now we have a pandemic with a highly contagious pathogen. And the first thing is, you know, if you do a spit test, that's really non-invasive. And you're just showing that you're doing everything you can. And if you do a big case, if I go to Lori Children's, do an outpatient case, they have to have the testing done. They're not going to do anyone without the testing. And so, and these tests have been around for forever for dentistry. It's not like it's something new. Now, the team members, that's a different story altogether. You know, can you actually test your team members? I keep asking what the Illinois State Dental Society is going to find out on this, because testing is really very important. I'd love to have all my team members come in and have them test IgG positive, you know. The issue, the attorney said, if you have testing that you could have done and you didn't, you may be liable. You know, you can't be liable for testing if it's okay. If you get the testing and it's a point of contact, a POC system, and the state says it's okay for you to test your employees and you've done it, then you've done everything you can to protect yourself and the other employee, which is why things like states like Alabama and their guidance for opening, they start off with employee protective measures. You got to protect the employees. Appointment only, no walk-in, everyone wears a mask, you check everyone for a temperature, no real waiting areas, you had keep people separated, 6 feet, N95 mask, all these things. And you have to instruct them, you have to meet with them and train them, which is what we're doing this week. We've had people who are just coming back on Wednesday. I've been working with a skeleton crew the whole time. And actually, I'm really tired. Really tired of doing a lot of this stuff. And then, you know, there's a lot of additional cleaning and so on to be prepared with, and protocol, as you guys know. And you know, if you're going to have a big aerosol, you have to use disposable gowns, not the cloth ones, but you can do cloth for non-aerosol procedures. And then, you know, again, checkouts and check-ins, they want people wearing gloves and to email things. We're not doing that. We're not having any contact. We're doing everything remotely, which I think is very important. And we're going to follow the protocols approved by the ADA for handling everything. And of course, we got our gowns, we got everything we need, and we have to protect, I love Alabama. We have to protect the customer. Couldn't they at least put down patient instead of customers? But I'm sure what they did was they took what they had for everyone. They put it together, you know, and just kind of transformed it into being appropriate for dental. So we did everything on this list, you know. Any bathroom in the office will be sanitized by staff after every use, and using the HEPA filters that you saw in the inline, making sure that they aren't sick when they come in, all the stuff we've talked about. Indiana, Alabama, Indiana, they had really pretty detailed things about surface cleansing, like door handles, chairs, desks, elevators, and bathrooms. My question is, I'm in a building with other people. Am I supposed to be cleaning the elevator after everyone else's patients have left? I can clean the elevator button on the third floor, but who's cleaning it on the first floor? So there's some of these things I think aren't very well thought out. Scrubs, no one's supposed to wear scrubs home anymore. They have to change personal clothing. Thank God we have enough bathrooms for that. Indiana was really good on showing their acceptable isolation gowns and having nice pictures. And of course, I had to show the New York City style hefty garbage bags. You know, if you run out, just go buy some garbage bags. And we got a load of isolation gowns in just today. I swear someone converted garbage bags. I mean, it's just, they're so bad, just plastic. And I don't know who ordered that. I have to find out. And then, of course, we have the Illinois guidelines. Yay, right? Finally, we got some guidelines that came out. What was it, Friday night at 5:30, and I got it at 7:30, to resume provision of routine oral and dental care consistent with this guidance. That doesn't help too much, does it? Especially when you can think about, we have to get to work for a lot of these people who are uncomfortable, and they say, you guys just have to be consistent to our guidance. And so use techniques to reduce aerosolization, high volume evacuation, of course, portable operated HEPA filters of appropriate size placement maintenance. That's in place. Got HEPA filters everywhere. Use a properly designed and maintained UV system. Well, I hope it is. That's all I can say. I hope it is. COVID-19 testing, they got right there. From the Illinois, this is quoted from it. Dentists may choose to incorporate COVID-19 testing as outlined below. History of those with confirmed COVID-19 infection, test-based strategy resolution, negative results for at least two consecutive swab specimens collected greater than 24 hours apart. So that means like they come back twice to be tested. And this is, of course, the molecular one. This is looking for the nucleic acid, the RNA-based test. And then they have the asymptomatic patients, so no signs or symptoms of infection, and a recent result that is negative, and they've self-quarantined themselves. And they can be considered low risk. So basically what we're doing is number two. I think everyone wants to go to door number two on that. And then you have this guidance that they want us to go by, but they don't actually say anything. They just say very high risk of aerosol production. So I guess if you wanted to, you could still scale with a sonic ultrasonic instrument, produce a aerosol, and that's just high risk, they're saying, but you can still do it. So I guess they just say you have to have all the gear if you want to do it that way. So to me, their guidance wasn't very specific. At least I don't think so. Maybe that was done intentionally so we have a little bit more leeway in how we treat our patients. So anyway, I want to thank you all for listening to me for the last hour. this is constantly changing, and I have a legal disclaimer in there. I don't want anyone saying that, hey, Mark, I heard you talk about this and now I'm doing it, because I don't really, I'm just doing the best I can. I hope you guys picked up a few things. And like I said, it's everyone has different ideas for how to address this, but Doug and Mike and Buddy and Scott, it's really good to see you, Ralph, and everyone else. So any quick comments?
Oh, there we go.
Yep. Mark, that was fantastic and comforting to hear you bring all these topics up. I did write a couple of questions I had along the way. Can you see the two questions that I wrote in the chat box, or is I could just read them out?
No, I can go up here. I can find them.
Yeah. Well, the
chat, I see there's two. Yep, right here.
I'm not sure if people are familiar with the Zoom presentations. You can just type your questions in as the presenter goes along. So at the end of the presentation, they can just take a peek and see what questions came up.
Oh, this guy wanted, what brand air purifier? I just got the Germ Guardian, because at least they had down that it was certified by somebody. I mean, a lot of them, I see a lot advertised for dentists, but there's no certification at all. At least the Germ Guardian, their association of the air purifiers, has at least looked at it. I mean, it happens to be by far the cheapest one out there too, by far. But what I'll know, because when I start doing the testing, the surface testing, I'll know what's getting by it. And so, you have to realize none of these have actually been tested against coronavirus too. And then Mark Landau wants to know, to sterilize the N95 mask. I've been using, and this is just because, yeah, you take it off, you have to do something with it once you touch it. I've been using ozone. They go into an ozone bag and I let them set for ozone. Now, when you do ozone, it does kill everything. It even kills the elastic. So after you ozone it like three times, elastic just like falls apart. So it's done. The vaporous hydrogen peroxide with the microwave sterilizer, that's what the state of Illinois is using. So, you know, anytime you do vaporous hydrogen peroxide, that really works against viruses. I do have a UV sterilizer coming, but I don't know how good it is. It's probably a piece of junk. I mean, unfortunately, you guys have all seen some stuff coming in that's recently made. They're producing it really super, super fast. It's an ozone generator, and it generates a lot of ozone. And these are just vacuum bags that everyone has their initials on. So at least you're putting your mask back in a bag that's your own bag. Because I didn't know how else to handle it, because I don't want these masks just laying around. And, you know, again, you have people who go, I got to go to the bathroom. Well, if they go to the bathroom and they flush the toilet and they're wearing their mask, that mask is all contaminated. So I'd rather they take the mask off and at least microwave it while they're in the bathroom and come back with clean hands, right? I mean, Brian's thinking about it. Brian Jacobs, I can see the little wheels.
I gotta go to the bathroom right now.
Yeah, going like, you know, that's actually, let me think about it. People have to go to the bathroom.
I just signed up for the Battelle service today that the ISDS sent out, the free third decontamination, I guess they call it. And it was actually pretty simple to do. And so if you can get enough to get, you know, a week's supply, or I guess 2 weeks, you can, you know, save a week, send it in through the next week, and you'll have the other ones back 72 hours, they said.
Well, no, that's what we're going to do too. But I'm just talking about
day-to-day, if you're going to really try and have any contact and try and follow it as strictly as you can with that.
Yeah, because anytime you take off that mask, it's contaminated. If you take it off to eat lunch, you've contaminated it.
Right. No. The CDC does have their extended use and reuse.
Yep.
Kind of guideline, but obviously that's a compromise, like you said.
Yeah.
Mark, do you need an N95 mask for all procedures?
No.
Okay. That's good.
No, if it's a non-aerosol procedure, you can get by with a level 3.
Okay, and in my profession, do I need the high volume evacuation?
Yeah, if you're going to be taking off brackets and polishing afterwards, yes.
Okay, just want to be sure.
And actually, there's people who say, if you talk to Mike Durbin, he says even placing brackets and bands and cleaning up afterwards, that's an aerosol-producing procedure.
Yeah, if you're going to polish the teeth first, of course.
Yep, yep. Okay. So,
Mark, what is specifically the ozone bag or that you're using? What is that?
Oh, it's ozone generator. It's a high, you can get those from anywhere. It's just a big ozone generator. And it produces a lot of ozone fast. And again, ozone's toxic, so you have to be careful with it. But I put my mask in there. I zipper it shut. I fill the bag full of ozone, turn it off, and it stays ozone in there while I'm eating lunch. And then I open it up and let it air out because it's not good for you. It smells too. But at least it's clean while I'm eating lunch. You know, it's... otherwise, we'd be going through so many masks, you know, with bathroom breaks and people going back to have a cup of coffee. You can just imagine, especially when you get a big office and got a lot of employees, you know. So the disinfectant shield is like $200 a gallon.
Mark, how do you handle the 6-foot rule with your assistants being right there on the patient's face?
Well, they have to be 6-foot rule is if you're treating a patient, you have to be closer than 6 feet and you have to be closer than them. But you've got a gown, gloves, level 3 mask, and a face shield on.
Okay.
No problem. Oh, by the way, what I did was to bump out my face shield. I didn't show you guys half the stuff. I bought some of those face shields that are caps with a shield down in front. You guys seen those? So you can wear loops. You know, where it's at, hey, hi, Nadine. I got to see you finally. It has the face shield on a cap. It's like a baseball cap. And then the baseball cap you wash with your scrubs, and the face shield pops off the baseball cap. I didn't put those pictures in, and I had to limit things a little bit. But I got the black ones to match our black scrubs. And so it looks good. It's a good look. And then let's see what else on that. Oh, yeah, go to Home Depot and buy some additional foam rubber insulation with the adhesive on one side, like you use in windows. You can bump out your face mask a little bit more so your loops will clear. So when you buy your face mask, they have the foam rubber, and your loops won't clear. Just put a little bit more foam rubber there.
Good idea.
Yeah. So I basically have used up every imaginable thing because of seeing these emergencies. I'm like, my loops don't work. What the hell? So that's basically it. So, hey, guys, I hate to say it. I have to run because
I got a question for you.
Yeah.
Okay. With all you've done, this is a practical question. And
it relates
to how much you're going to increase your fees to pay for all the things you're doing.
Oh, God, you got to, not only that, but it's
I'm asking you that question, okay? Because I'm going to ask you another practical question because, you know, all the hairdressers are opening up all over America, all right? And they sit on top of their patients. And I realize what you've got here, but to me, all right, I'm not so sure it is an overkill. And I mean that. I believe in protection. I really do. And I'm not a dentist. I'm not practicing anymore. But I'm just saying to you, all these guidelines, what's it gonna end, where is it gonna end up when this threat goes down, and what are we gonna do? Are you gonna continue this for long term, or this is short term?
Well, you have three really great questions there. And first question is really with the hairdressers and so on. They're not creating an aerosol in your mouth. They're not creating an aerosol at all when they cut your hair.
Yeah.
You know, they're going to be wearing masks. They're going to be wearing gloves.
The aerosol doesn't endanger the patient. The aerosol endangers you.
And the person getting there, the other patient in the next room, if there's no separation. So,
no, but if you've got a separate, you got separation, then you have no problem.
I have separation.
Well,
yeah.
I always have separation.
Yeah.
Close doors.
fees have to go up, and I'm guessing a percentage of 20 to 25% across the board. That's what I'm guessing. I'm just guessing right now, because it's not the PPE, it's the additional time in between each patient. Brian's shaking his head, yes. It's the additional time between each patient, changing, letting the room sit. All these guidelines are very, very expensive, and they may be overkill. And you know, what's really funny is if you saw the studies that came out yesterday, they think the children don't actually transmit it, coronavirus. Not only do the vast majority not show any symptoms when they get sick with it, they think the vast majority of kids are not reservoirs. And they know this because of studies they've done in Sweden, Austria, and other countries where they did not shut down the schools. Now, you know, one of the biggest things about this, which is mind-blowing, is the Home Depot study. And very few people realize this, but Home Depot, Target, Whole Foods have been recording the illnesses. Well, everyone knows this now, I'm pretty sure. Have been recording the illness rate of their employees. And Home Depot, when they kept open, never closed, they didn't have masks for the vast majority of their employees. You could walk into Home Depot, because it was an essential business, go right up to a guy, have him help you pick out some paint and walk out. I know, because I was in there a lot making my my shields for the reception desk, right? And guess what? No increase in illnesses, because they have a direct, they can, you know, they got right in their computer, right in their employee database. And the same thing with Whole Foods, and the same thing with Target, and a bunch of companies that are backing off. They're saying, oh, we didn't really share your information. They didn't. It was de-identified. They just gave numbers. How many sick do you have this week? How many sick do you have this week? How many people called in sick? Then they tried to extrapolate out people who are just trying to get off work. So it's really interesting. I'm not sure how much all the PPE had as an effect. And again, going back to the toilets, I think they underestimated the effect of hand spread, especially in restaurants. Especially in restaurants. And some of the thing that may have flattened the curve the most was the fact that you're cooking at home. Yeah, I really worry about, you know, someone being sick, being cooking your food for you, and all that stuff. Anyway, hey, I got to run.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you, Mark. Everybody.
Take care. Thank you. Bye, guys.
Bye.